It is now time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, to the Premier, I'm going to try again today. The question is not about infrastructure. The question is not about valuation. The question is not about 2002 or previous governments or past premiers. The question is not about leveraging assets. The question isn't about restructuring
Minister of Finance.
Ontario Hydro. The question is not about the 407. My question is sincere. My question is simple. Mr. Speaker, yes or no, does the Premier think paying the Hydro One CEO $4 million is appropriate? Yes or no?
Thank you. I will start right off the bat. Premier.
Well, Mr. Speaker, let me just begin by commenting that the median salary for CEOs of American energy companies was over $7 million last year, Mr. Speaker. That's the median salary for American energy companies, Mr. Speaker. And I think the leader of the opposition knows that a large part of that compensation package for the CEO of Hydro One will be dependent on, will be at risk if the company doesn't improve, if there isn't better customer service, Mr. Speaker, if there isn't better health and safety for workers. So he knows that those factors are in place. But Mr. Speaker, the whole discussion, contrary to what the leader of the opposition said, the whole discussion about Hydro One is about investment in infrastructure.
Answer.
That's what it's about. It is about. That's why we are making these changes, so that we can invest in the infrastructure that we need for the 21st century.
Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier, rather than comparing to corporate America, compare to other provinces. Hydro-Quebec, $400,000 compared to your $4 million payout. Regardless of the mess this government has made of the personal support worker wage increase, I can tell you a PSA can make little over $30,000 a year. And notwithstanding the cuts across the province to special education, we know educational assistants make around $35,000. And despite the fact that government has cut hundreds of nurses across Ontario, a new nurse will make over $50,000 a year. Yet knowing all this, the government still thinks it's appropriate to pay $24 million a year for just the top four paid executives at Hydro One. Mr. Speaker, knowing all this information, knowing all the cuts you've done to frontline services, how can you find this appropriate?
Well, Mr. Speaker, let's just...
You see this, please? Thank you. I'm asking everyone. This will be the last time I interrupt to ask. I will then move to warnings.
Well, Mr. Speaker, the question from the Leader of the Opposition and the heckling from the Leader of the Third Party would lead one to believe that they actually supported our increases to personal support workers' salaries and development support workers and ECEs, Mr. Speaker. They didn't support them, Mr. Speaker. They didn't support those increases, Mr. Speaker. So it's a bit rich coming from the two of them to attack us about our support for those workers. Mr. Speaker, the broadening the ownership of Hydro One is about investing in infrastructure that, in fact, Mr. Speaker, will provide opportunity for the very people that the Leader of the Opposition and the Leader of the Third Party seem to be worried about, Mr. Speaker. Making sure that we have companies in this province that can move their goods and their people around,
Answer.
Mr. Speaker. Making sure that the quality of life for people who depend on transit, Mr. Speaker, that quality of life is improved. That's what these investments are about. It's why we're broadening the ownership of
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier. Single parents are working two jobs and barely staying afloat. Some of our school support staff are clearing $40,000 a year. The average truck driver makes somewhere between $25,000 and $50,000 a year. Corrections officers are making $55,000 a year, and sometimes and often in very unsafe conditions. Mr. Speaker, I've asked over and over again, and the government has been disingenuous and seems to just not care. I'll give them one more shot. Mr. Speaker, to the Premier, Give me one reason it's appropriate, one reason why it's appropriate to pay the Hydro One CEO $4 million a year. It is not even close to what other Hydro CEOs are making anywhere else in Canada. One reason.
Thank you. The member from Renfrew is warned. Who's next? Premier?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. You know, Mr. Speaker, we ran on and are implementing a plan that is based in the investment in the people of this province. We believe, Mr. Speaker, and I will tell you, having traveled to California and China, I am even more convinced that our advantage in Ontario is our people, making sure that they have the education and the skills that they need, Mr. Speaker, for the 21st century. They are our advantage. But, Mr. Speaker, in order for those people to be at their best, we need, as a government, to make the investments that will allow them to thrive, whether that's in our education system, our colleges and universities. Funding for those institutions has been going up, Mr. Speaker, continues to go up. Whether it is the investment in infrastructure that we absolutely need in order to be able to compete, that's the plan that we have put in.
The member from Stormont is warned.
Investigating and in implementing. Mr. Speaker, it is a plan that is comprehensive. So the Leader of the Opposition has taken one piece. He doesn't, for reasons unknown to us, like the idea of improving Hydro One. We think that it should.
Thank you. The member from Leeds-Grenville is warned. New question. The Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, to the Premier, the government can't have it both ways. The Deputy Premier routinely shouts about the 1% when we question the government's cut to physician services, but the front bench over there is the first to defend the outrageous salary of Hydro One's CEO, one that is almost 40 times that of a new doctor. Further to that, the Financial Accountability Officer report has said the government hopes that measures to reduce physician fees will help them reach their targets. They have already cut the portion of health care three times in the last year.
The member from Eglinton Lords
Mr. Speaker,
is warned.
How many more times will the government slash physician
fees? The Minister of Agriculture is warned.
And when can doctors expect the next cut?
Premier.
So, Mr. Speaker, now we're going to talk about some of the people in the province who earn the most money, that they should earn more, Mr. Speaker. That's now where we're going. So the inconsistency that continues to come from the opposite side is quite remarkable. Mr. Speaker, what we're defending as a government in our plan is the right of the people of Ontario to have excellent institutions in their education and their health care system, to have the investments in infrastructure, whether it's roads, bridges, transit, water systems, that they need in order to be able to compete, Mr. Speaker, to have a government that is going to work with businesses to allow them to flourish and to become exporters, Mr. Speaker, to open doors around the world, to allow them to expand and to compete globally. That's what we're defending, Mr. Speaker. That's the plan we're implementing. And I'm sorry that the Leader of the Opposition is so inconsistent that he can't either see that or understand that we have to do all of those things.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier, you want to talk about consistency? A $4 million salary for a Hydro One CEO is appropriate, but a family doctor making 1/40th of the salary isn't appropriate? Give me a break. You know, Mr. Speaker, just a few weeks ago, I was visiting Windsor, and I went to the Windsor Regional Hospital. There, I met just a handful of the 800,000 Ontarians without a family doctor.
The member from Trinity Spadina is warned.
From family doctors, like Dr. Jen Bondi, who just made it under the wire before your cuts to be joined by her family health team. Many of her fellow new physicians have described the medical profession as having an all-time morale and at an all-time low. They feel the Liberals have launched a systematic attack on doctors. Many are threatening to leave Ontario because of these cuts to the system.
Question.
Mr. Speaker, how can this government justify the cuts to health care? Give us a justification for these cuts.
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
The Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Mr. Speaker, there are a number of issues I think it's important for Ontarians to know that one of them is that we have increased the physician services budget. So the monies that the government, roughly 10 cents out of every dollar this government spends in the province that goes to physician services, those hardworking frontline workers, we've increased that by 1.25% last year, this year by the same amount, next year by the same amount again. And we've asked our physicians to accept that modest increase in the overall budget, and it will mean some challenges in terms of us having to make sure that we stay within that budget, but so it is so that we can provide those increases to our PSWs across the province,
yeah.
And so we can invest more in home and community care, as we are doing $250 million more this year. It's so we can continue to invest more money in mental health and addictions. I believe that the majority of physicians across this province support that of a sustainable health care budget and investing in other priorities.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier, the only physician that supports the physician cuts is the Minister of Health. The Liberal government is gutting health care in Ontario. Governments and leadership is about making priorities. Your priorities, Premier, are $2.5 billion for the Pan Am Games, $24 million for overpaid execs at Hydro One, $3.7 million to unions without a single receipt. Why is health care not a priority? On my Windsor trip, I learned from Dr. Darren Cargill that the Windsor hospital that he works at doesn't even have a palliative care team. We have 800,000 Ontarians without a family doctor, yet this government just cut 50 residency spots. When will this government make health care a priority?
Well, Mr. Speaker, I think the leader of the official opposition already knows that health care is a top priority of this government.
Yeah,
$50 billion invested in that. We're proud of all our health care workers, more than 250,000 of them around this province. But, Mr. Speaker, it's simply not true that we're changing our investments or our commitments to doctors across the province. We put 70 separate savings opportunities in front of the OMA over the course of a year of negotiations.
Yep.
We did not receive a single piece of advice or reply from the OMA on a single one of them. We had an independent umpire, Warren Winkler, retired Justice Warren Winkler, come forward and implore the OMA to accept the government's fair offer at that time last fall. The OMA rejected that fair offer. And, Mr. Speaker, we have repeatedly indicated to the OMA that we're prepared to negotiate with them, to sit down and have discussions. To date, the OMA has refused to continue those discussions, Mr. Speaker. We implore them to do that.
New question, the Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Last week, Ed Clark told a business crowd at a $1,000 a plate luncheon that he wants to open our health care system to the private sector. When did the Premier give Ed Clark the mandate to open our health care system to U.S. style privatization, Speaker?
Thank you, Premier.
So, Mr. Speaker, I'm going to give the Leader of the Third Party another example of what Ed Clark was talking about, and that is the development of skills and experience here that we have in education and health, that those can be useful to the world. There, on our trip to China, Mr. Speaker, there was a group from a family health team here right in Toronto, Mr. Speaker, and that group was signing agreements in China with medical practitioners there and students there, Mr. Speaker, to share information, to do some training on how we have organized family health teams in some of the practices here, Mr. Speaker. That's the kind of opportunity that we need to continue to look for because, Mr. Speaker, quite frankly, the knowledge and expertise that has been developed here, of course it's good for Ontarians, but it can be good for the world, Mr. Speaker. That's what Ed Clark is talking about.
Speaker, yesterday I asked the Premier about Ed Clark's new plan to link our health care system to the private sector. While the Premier chooses to fire nurses, close beds, and is now choosing to open the door to U.S.-style private health care, I'm proud to actually defend public health care in Ontario, Speaker. Will the Premier make it clear to Ed Clark and make it clear to the 13 million Ontarians who rely on our public health care system that health care should be about families and not
shareholders? Minister of Economic Development is warned. Thank you. Premier.
Mr. Speaker, I'm honest. honestly not sure whether the leader of the third party actually understands what it is we're talking about, because she's decided on a piece of rhetoric, Mr. Speaker, that actually bears no resemblance to what it is we're talking about. I'm going to give her two more examples, Mr. Speaker. So when we were in China, TV Ontario and CBS Consulting Inc. of Markham, Ontario, have entered into an agreement to provide English language high school courses to Chinese students. Great. That's an investment of $250,000, creating four jobs. So, Mr. Speaker, here's an example of educational expertise that has been developed here in Ontario that we can now leverage and partner with people in another country to allow them to have access to that expertise, Mr. Speaker. And I will give another example in the supplementary.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
I prefer the Premier just answer my question in the final supplementary, Speaker. Ontario has been a leader in medical research.
Minister of Education
Everybody
is
knows
warned.
That, Speaker. And we have shared that research with the world. I am proud of that, Speaker. Whether it's medication, whether it's surgical techniques, people around the world benefit every day from Ontario's leadership, and we've accomplished this within the framework, Speaker, of our public health care system. We should continue to share our research, Speaker. We should continue to be a centre for innovation, Speaker, when it comes to health care. But I am proud to defend public health care in Ontario, and I sure hope this Liberal government is prepared to do the same. And so I ask, Mr. Speaker, will this Premier do the right thing and tell Ed Clark unequivocally that health care should be public and not private?
Thank you.
So, Mr. Speaker, we defend publicly funded health care in Ontario. We stand for publicly funded health care in Ontario, Mr. Speaker. But there are opportunities, and I will give the leader of the third party another example. Sick Kids Hospital and Fudan Hospital, Children's Hospital of Fudan University in China, Mr. Speaker, have signed a memorandum of understanding. It's a multi-year partnership to support neonatology. It will provide advisory services to support the design, quality improvement, and workflow of a new CHFU neonatal tower. It will provide the development of education and training programs for physicians, nurses, and management to be delivered in both China and Canada. Mr. Speaker, there's an opportunity that within the framework of publicly funded health care will provide opportunity, will save lives, and will benefit both China and Ontario, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Speaker. New Democrats believe in publicly funded and publicly delivered health care. That's what we hope the Liberals are working on. Next question is to the Premier. Speaker, last week the Minister of Finance told me that the Liberal government will, quote, will do everything necessary to maximize the potential of our assets. Does that include selling off even more of Ontario's revenue-generating assets, Speaker?
Mr. Speaker, the leader of the third party has, I presume, read our budget, read our platform, read our budget, understands what we are doing, Mr. Speaker. She understands that Ed Clark has given us advice on leveraging Hydro One, Mr. Speaker. She understands that we are committed to selling some real estate, Mr. Speaker. She understands that we were committed to selling GM shares. She understands that that money is going in to invest in transit across this province, in roads and bridges and infrastructure across this province, Mr. Speaker. She knows full well that we have taken the advice of the assets group, Mr. Speaker, that we are broadening the ownership of Hydro One. She knows that that's the plan. She knows we're going ahead and implementing it, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you.
Gee, Speaker, the slogan for their last week of the campaign should have been a vote for Wynn is a vote for Hudak. Anyways, the Premier, Speaker, won't rule out selling more assets. And her ministers keep opening the door to more sell-offs. Her unelected banker, Speaker, is now talking about privatizing health care and post-secondary education. Will the Premier stop listening to bankers? Start listening to people, Speaker, and come clean about whether or not she is planning to sell off more of Ontario's revenue-generating assets.
Thank you.
You know, Mr. Speaker, I know that there are some points to be gained by sort of flip comments from the leader of the third party, but Mr. Speaker, we're at a very serious juncture in this province. Our economy is in transition, and it's in transition, Mr. Speaker, because of global forces. It's not in transition because of anything that any individual company or politician has done in Ontario. We are in transition because the nature of manufacturing is changing, Mr. Speaker. We're in transition because we need modern, updated infrastructure, Mr. Speaker. We're in transition because the world of technology has changed, and it has changed all over the world. If we don't keep up, if we don't make the investments that are needed at this juncture, Mr. Speaker, we will fall behind, despite the fact that we have a highly educated workforce, despite the fact that we have all the resources that we need. We will fall behind if we make the wrong decisions. You. The leader of the third party is counseling the wrong decisions.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Speaker, this premier knows exactly what she's doing. She could rule out selling off more of Ontario's revenue-generating assets. It would be easy to rule that out, Speaker, but she will not do that. Instead, the premier and her ministers are offering Ontarians more doublespeak, Speaker. Why won't the premier just be clear and transparent, as she so much indicated she was going to do from day one and hasn't done yet? Why will she not be transparent and open with Ontarians and tell them straight up, right here in this House, if she is going to be selling off more of Ontario's revenue-generating assets?
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, the leader of the third party knows full well that we are implementing the plan that we put forward in our budget, Mr. Speaker. We are implementing that plan, and in that plan, we said we were going to take the advice of the Assets Council. We have taken that advice. We are broadening the ownership of Hydro One. There's nothing else in the plan, Mr. Speaker, in terms of assets. So, what I would say to the leader of the third party is the openness that we have brought to this process by being clear that we are investing in infrastructure, and in order to do that, we needed the revenue, we needed the funds in order to be able to do that, Mr. Speaker. That's what we brought to the people of Ontario. That's the plan we're implementing, and because of that plan, there will be projects. There are projects being built all over this province, in rural, in northern, in southwestern, in eastern, and southern Ontario, in order to make communities more viable, to make communities more attractive to business, and allow us to thrive into the 21st
Thank
century,
you.
Mr. Speaker.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. New question, the member from Renfrew-Nipissing-Pembroke.
My question is to the Minister of Energy. Not only is the minister continuing policies that will make hydro more expensive, but he is now centralizing power within his office. Bill 135 will effectively remove procurement and planning from the independent electricity systems operator and strip the Ontario Energy Board of its transmission approval authority.
There's your transparency.
These bodies are supposed to be autonomous and above political manipulation. However, that all changes if 135 becomes law. My question, Speaker, is this. What has the ISO and the OEB done that the minister feels it is necessary to strip them of their authority, which will surely result in further unmitigated disasters and scandals in our electricity system?
Thank you. Minister of Energy.
Mr. Speaker, I always appreciate the bombast with which my critic provides questions. And sometimes it's important to actually look at the facts, for example. The legislation, Mr. Speaker, has a process to empower the IESO to undertake competitive selection or procurement processes for electricity transmission projects when appropriate, Mr. Speaker. In terms of energy system planning, the legislation would enshrine the long-term energy planning process that was developed in 2010 and 2013, Mr. Speaker, to ensure that future long-term plans are developed consistent with the principles of cost-effectiveness, reliability, clean energy, community and Aboriginal engagement. Particularly, Mr. Speaker, in terms of transmission, the independent electricity system operator would be authorized to plan and undertake competitive approaches for transmission selection and procurement. Mr. Speaker, it gives power to the IESO in planning and procurement.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Not what the industry says, Speaker. We've heard from expert and industry stakeholders who universally decry this undermining of the ISO and the OEB. They say this is no way to manage an energy system in the 21st century. Speaker, the smart meter program, done without the advice and expertise of the ISO, turned into yet another liberal energy scandal, costing ratepayers hundreds of million dollars more than was originally projected, and leaving homeowners with untrusted and unreliable devices. Another example is the Niagara-Caledonia-Middleport transmission line, which the OEB said was unnecessary. Yet the government went ahead anyway, and now it sits being unused after costing the people of Ontario $100 million. Speaker, will the minister tell us who will protect generators, stakeholders, and ratepayers from further Liberal disasters and scandals if Bill 135 becomes law?
Thank you. Minister.
Mr. Speaker, I find it amazing that he would suggest, even, Mr. Speaker, that the ISO was not involved in inaugurating the smart meters, Mr. Speaker. I happen to have been on the board of the ISO between 2007 and 2010. They, in fact, did all the software. They did all the work to create the smart meters, Mr. Speaker. They did all the oversight in implementing smart meters, Mr. Speaker. So I don't know where he gets off by saying the ISO had nothing to do with smart meters. They created the software, they created the program, they created all the oversight for implementation, Mr. Speaker. So he better get his facts straight.
Yeah. New question. The member from Toronto, Danforth.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question to the Premier. Since the Premier is selling off Hydro One, Hydro One profits will be going to the private sector. But the bills are still coming to the province, not Hydro One. 15% of Hydro One's profits will go to Bay Street, but 100% of a $3 million bill for IPO-related expenses will go straight to the province. Wow. That means Ontarians will pay the bill, not Hydro One, not its new private investors. If this is such a great deal, why are Ontario families going to be stuck paying this bill?
Wow. Commissioner Finance.
So we have the broadening of ownership of Hydro One. We just finished the IPO. We just sourced $3 billion as a result to invest in other assets, into the Trillium Trust. And we also had an additional $1 billion in special dividends just prior to the IPO, which again enables us to enhance the value of Hydro One and the benefit to the shareholders, which 84% of which are Ontarians and the taxpayer. And the broadening of ownership, Mr. Speaker, included 40% retailers from Ontario. Bottom line is, we have a company that's now valued more, is more efficient, has greater board governance and executive control, and the company is outperforming than it's ever done before, and it will continue to provide greater benefit to us as shareholders of the company that we still have, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary.
Speaker, it didn't take long for the Premier to give in to her very powerful friends. They will get 15% of Hydro One's profit, and they'll pay 0% of this $3 million bill. This bill was for the period that ended September 30th. The IPO didn't close until November 5th, and the Premier is still planning to sell more. How much more will Ontario families be paying so that Bay Street investors don't have to pay a cent?
Mr. Speaker, the value of Hydro One and the shareholders, us as owners of this company, has now been determined at the high end. That's net of all these other expenses that the member is speaking of. We have just maintained and enabled this company to provide greater value, provide greater capital gains for the province that we're now able to reinvest to produce new assets at even greater returns. The member opposite is making claims that is actually monies that have been awarded to ourselves. We are the ones benefiting from all of this at the end, not some other mystical operation. The fact is, the net result of this IPO has enabled us to source $3 billion more for other investments in the province while still retaining 86% ownership of a corporation, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question. Member from Kingston in the Islands.
Mr. Speaker, human rights are an essential staple in any democracy. Not only my constituents in Kingston and the Islands, but all of Ontario should be proud of the leadership
Who?
This province
Question.
Has
Who,
taken.
Please?
Oh, sorry. It's for the Minister, the Attorney General. Sometimes I feel as though excellent leadership goes unnoticed. Mr. Speaker, through you to the Minister, could the Attorney General enlighten this House on how this government has ensured human rights are preserved for every Ontarian?
Attorney General.
Mr. Speaker, first of all, I want to thank the MPP for Kingston and the Island for our very important question. And I also agree that the defense of human rights is an essential part of our community. All Ontarians have the right to live free of discrimination, inequality, and intolerance. The protection of human rights is a fundamental principle in this province. This government has taken the most significant steps to strengthen our human rights system in 40 years to better ensure dignity and justice for all Ontarians. Our strengthened human rights system supports these rights by better enforcing Ontario Human Rights Code and ensuring dignity by providing timely and efficient access to justice for those who face discrimination in our community. And I'd like to take the opportunity to say how incredible, you know, the event at the mosque in Peterborough on Saturday night. So we are all behind this group
and
we support them deeply. Thank you, Mr.
Supplementary.
I thank the Attorney General for that answer. The work the province has done in this area is honourable and should be a model for other provinces. I was able to see firsthand that profound commitment to human rights and justice when the minister visited various organizations in Kingston and the Islands in the legal and social service fields. If the Attorney General would elaborate on the mandate of the Ontario Human Rights Tribunal, as well as some of the processes it uses to uphold human rights in this province, I'm sure this House would be very appreciative of the progress that has been made.
Thank you,
yes, thank you, Mr. Speaker. And yes, an excellent question. And through education, policy, development, and research and analysis, the Commission works to preserve the spirit of tolerance that has long characterized Ontario. In 2008, the Ontario government commissioned a report in order to maximize the potential of the human rights system in the province. I am proud to say that the majority of these recommendations have been implemented. In developing a new human rights system, we have provided quicker and more direct access to victims of discrimination. We have provided legal support to help those who would otherwise have difficult accessing justice, and we have focused resources to address systemic human rights issues. Human rights continue to be a priority for this government and this province. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question, member from Kitchener, Conestoga.
Thanks, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. This Thursday marks 1 year since the Liberal government's lack of winter preparedness and oversight allowed the QEW to be turned into a skating rink of traffic chaos for GTA motorists. 1 year later, the minister still says he has no idea what caused the mess and goes on, despite the auditor's warning, with the same safety-compromising cut-rate contracts his government introduced in 2009. As tragedies mount, evidence of the contract failings multiply, to the point that we've now seen the second regional contract fail and quietly go back up for tender in the last 6 months. The second. Two contracts have failed within half a year. Will the Premier now agree with the auditor and admit that their performance-based contracts have, in fact, placed the lives of Ontario motorists at risk?
Good question. Minister of Transportation.
Minister of Transportation.
Thanks, very much, Mr. Speaker. I have say in advance that my voice is a little bit weak this morning from a lingering cold. I do appreciate the question from the member of the opposition. He referenced the Auditor General's report from a number of months ago, asking whether or not the government agrees with the auditor's report. Of course, that report contained 8 recommendations, Speaker, and I said the very day that report was released, both in our press studio here in this building, but also here in this House repeatedly, that our government does accept all 8 of the recommendations that the auditor brought forward. But more importantly, or at least as importantly, Speaker, that's why prior to the auditor being asked to go in and examine this particular program. This government took proactive action with respect to making sure we had more resources, more equipment, and more materials out on our highways. We have since done a great deal of work between last winter season and the winter season that we are now in, Speaker. And my expectation is that our contractors will perform accordingly for this winter season. Thanks.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, while they talk about improvements, there is no new equipment for this winter. Fines levy continue to go uncollected. Bare pavement standards haven't changed, and they stick stubbornly to their same performance-based contract system that risks safety. New Twitter sites and plow tracking apps do nothing to help the person stuck on the highway in an accident because roads weren't cleared. Sudbury represents the second failed contract in the last 6 months. Even contractors themselves realize it's not working, and that's why they're dropping off the keys and walking away. That's why the first failed contract in Kenora led to only one bidder coming forward to take the job, and Speaker, they weren't even from Ontario. With the announced new RFP for Sudbury road clearing, will the Premier commit that they will not be repeating the performance-based contract mistakes that have led to so many winter tragedies for Ontario families on Ontario roads?
Thanks very much, Speaker. And again, I thank the member opposite for the supplementary question. I'm not quite sure where he is getting his information from, Speaker, with respect to the fact that he alleges that there's no new equipment, Speaker. From the period in time before the auditor's report right through into this upcoming winter season, actually the winter season that we're now technically in, Speaker, there are a great number of additional pieces of equipment that have been deployed to help deal with, for example, truck climbing lanes in the north, Speaker, but also ramps and shoulders here in southern Ontario. I find it interesting that in the first question, Speaker, the member would ask about the auditor's report, and then in the supplementary, he would effectively mock the government for fulfilling or following through on what the auditor recommended with respect to us providing updated information through the 511 website, Speaker, through the additional patrolling options that we have out there, Speaker. This is a very important upcoming winter season, or the season that we're in now. I've had the chance to speak to all of our contractors, as has the ministry. We expect this season that the people of Ontario will get the service that they expect and deserve. Thanks very much.
The question, the member from Nickelville.
My question is for the Prime Minister. The Premier.
A report and makes important recommendations to improve the safety of our loved ones in long-term care homes. After a 10-month delay, the latest report has been quietly posted online, and it reveals that this Liberal government is failing seniors, failing their family and the staff in the long-term care homes. This critical report says that there is a need to increase availability of staff for bedside care and confirms that the behavior support teams are, and I quote, not a replacement for sufficient numbers of caring staff who have time to spend with residents. Speaker, the Premier cannot ignore the scathing report, and she cannot ignore the growing needs of our seniors in long-term care homes. Will the Premier finally act on the urgent needs to improve support for seniors and frontline staff in our long-term care homes?
Associate Minister of Health.
Associate Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Thank you, Speaker. I'd like to thank the member opposite for the question and her advocacy. I would also like to thank the Coroner's Geriatric and Long-Term Care Committee for their hard work in producing this report. We look forward to a careful review of the recommendations. Mr. Speaker, the Coroner's report, the committee's report essentially acknowledge what we also acknowledge, which is the acuity of seniors in our long-term care homes has been growing for a long time. And in particular, there's a growing incidence of aggressive behaviors. And that is why, Mr. Speaker, we have launched, under the leadership of PA Indira Naidu Harris, a province-wide dementia strategy, and we look forward to the findings of that report. In the meantime, we continue to aggressively invest in behavioral support in Ontario, which is something that the coroner's report acknowledges. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary, the member from London Central.
Speaker, again to the Premier, every senior deserves to live in safety and dignity. But this scathing report confirms that the Liberals are failing 78,000 residents of long-term care homes in Ontario. The coroner is urging the government to take immediate action to address the growing needs of seniors and to finally address understaffing in long-term care. The report makes 112 urgent recommendations, and while the Premier has no obligation to even respond to this report, Speaker, new Democrats are speaking up today because we all have an obligation to ensure that our seniors and long-term care staff live and work in safety. Will the Premier do the right thing for Ontario seniors and commit today to publicly respond to all the coroner's recommendations before this House rises? And if not,
question.
Why not?
Thank you.
Thank you, Speaker. And as I said in my previous answer, we are studying the report. It just came out recently, and we are going to be reviewing all of the recommendations. In the meantime, we are going to continue with our going forward with consulting on our dementia strategy. I also want to say, Mr. Speaker, that the report very clearly acknowledges the skill and dedication of our frontline workers in our long-term care homes. I want to thank the report's authors for acknowledging it, and I want to echo that, and I want to also ensure this House and reassure this House that the safety of our seniors continues to be number one priority. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Okay, new question, the member from Ajax Pickering.
Speaker, my question is
I thought I sent a message. Carry on.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Tourism, Culture and Sport. And as the member of Provincial Parliament for Ajax Pickering, I can tell you I'm happy to be a part of the discussion around the sport promotion in Aboriginal communities, as some of my friends have sponsored the annual Aboriginal hockey tournament just west of here, a great event. The Community Aboriginal Recreation Activator, commonly known as CARA, program improves the quality of life and well-being of First Nation, Inuit and Métis communities through sport and recreation. By supporting them, their communities through local initiatives, we help facilitate the creation of a community-driven recreation plan. A greater understanding of local needs, communities can provide solutions for regional needs for sport, recreation, and wellness. So, Mr. Speaker,
question.
To the Minister of Tourism and Culture, can the Minister please share more about the CARA program with us?
Thank you, Minister of Tourism and Culture and Sport.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'd like to thank the member from Ajax Pickering for the question. The Community Aboriginal Recreation Activator Program, CARA, helps to build and support strong and vibrant communities across Ontario. And through community-run programs, we help facilitate local initiatives that help encourage young people to participate in sport and recreation. Initiatives like this allow young people throughout the communities it serves, Mr. Speaker, to participate in multimedia, in sport recreation, to connect with the great outdoors and local sport programming. And I'm happy, Mr. Speaker, that the CARA program is recognized as one of the most successful programs in the communities that it serves. And Mr. Speaker, we've been able to double the participation level within these programs over the last year to bring us to 57,000 young people participating throughout Ontario. Mr. Speaker, this is exactly the type of program that makes me proud to be part of this government.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you, Minister. It's 7 years of operation. The CARA program has contributed to an improvement in wellness and improved quality of life through sport, recreation, and physical activity opportunities. I'm proud of our government's commitment to promoting sport and wellness in Aboriginal communities across Ontario. Recently, Minister of Tourism, Culture and Sport attended the CARA training symposium on behalf of our government. That was you, Minister, and I'm told that the CARA training symposium featured a variety of workshops, different events, and offered opportunities for continued education for both sport and recreation. Mr. Speaker, can the Minister please share with the House the impact of the continued educational opportunities for CARA on program leaders, and are we doing a good job on this, Minister?
Thank you. Minister.
Mr. Speaker, yes, we are. We're doing a fantastic job. And more importantly, Mr. Speaker, the community activators throughout Ontario that are part of these programs are doing an incredible job with the young people in the communities they serve. Mr. Speaker, I had the opportunity to go to the symposium 2 weeks ago, and it was amazing to talk to these young leaders in their communities who participate in these programs. And I got to I got to watch a video of these four young women from Lac Seul, which is a First Nation community in Ontario, and to see these these four young women pick up a camera and put together a music video through partnership with the CARA program. It was just incredible to see. In fact, Mr. Speaker, if you go onto YouTube and put in Echo My Soul, you'll see that they've got 26,000 hits on this video, and it's part of this program. And they're talking about their community, their culture, and it's through programs like this, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Your question, the member from Perth, Wellington.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Community and Social Services. Right now, there are at least 14,000 adults with developmental disabilities on the wait list for housing. The need is extremely urgent. To get help, one mother had to declare her son homeless. Another young man with autism had to be locked in a psychiatric ward. When Global News approached the minister for her thoughts, she stated, "Are you sure you want to talk to me?" How insulting. It is the minister's job to provide answers and hope to those affected by this crisis. Why won't the minister provide an answer? Is it because the real answer would expose her and her government's total and inexcusable lack of action?
Good question. Minister of Community and Social Services.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I'm very happy to respond to the question from the member opposite. First of all, our government recognizes the efforts and commitments of families who are supporting their adult children with developmental disabilities. We understand those challenges, and we want to work with them. This is why, of course, we did establish developmental service organizations across the province to ensure equity across the province in terms of prioritization, in terms of moving to residential support services. And of course, we also want to enable people with developmental disabilities to live and participate as fully as possible in their communities. This is why we made the investment of $810 million to help those with developmental disabilities. And in fact, we are making good progress in providing new residential supports. This year alone, we have supplied 500 additional residential spaces.
Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, that kind of answer is meaningless for families suffering because of this government's misplaced priorities. They're cutting secret million-dollar checks to teachers' unions, but to the most vulnerable amongst us, they are being total tightwads.
Shameful.
How long will it take to cut down the housing wait list? Global asked, but the minister wouldn't say. The Auditor General told us at the current rate, it will take 22 years. That's assuming nobody else joins the list.
Oh.
Families need housing solutions now, not decades down the road. Speaker, will the minister apologize to families, take responsibility, and start helping those most in need? And will she do it now?
Thank you, Minister.
Well, first of all, Mr. Speaker, I do want to emphasize that families that are on the residential wait list are already receiving some forms of support through our direct funding programs. In other words, they are receiving supports within the community to assist them while they await residential placement. We have established our housing task force, and I've had the opportunity to travel around the province to make announcements of these demonstration projects. Those with developmental disabilities vary considerably as individuals, as we would expect. Some people need very, very strong support in their communities. They may have complex medical needs. So we're looking at innovative ways to house individuals in their communities, working in partnership with the community agencies that they need. We have some 12 demonstration projects, and we will have another 12 very shortly.
Thank you. Your question, the Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. 20,000 pensioners who worked for U.S. Steel and their families have had their pension benefits cut off since October. The Minister of Finance rose in this House to say that the government was going to kick in $3 million over 6 months as a transition fund. The problem is, Speaker, nobody really knows how this transition fund is being administered or how to access the help these pensioners desperately need, the help the minister has promised, Speaker. Pensioners are now writing to the Ministry of Health and Long-Term Care, in fact, and the company, not knowing where it is that they should be turning to get the help that was promised by the Minister of Finance. Nearly 2 months after these benefits were cut, will the Premier tell this House where is the $3 million to help, of help that she and her minister promised to the pensioners?
Question. Thank you.
Minister of Finance.
Minister of Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I also wish to acknowledge the work that's being done by the member from Hamilton East, Tony Creek, for his good work and advocacy on that side of the bench, Mr. Speaker. We recognize that working together and collaboratively, we can help those most in need, and that's what's happening here. And the Government of Ontario has been at the table, has been trying to encourage support for those families. That's why we've earmarked the $3 million to support the transition that's going forward. But it's a longer-term process than that, Mr. Speaker. We're trying to enable this operation to be a going concern, to enable those families, those workers, to continue working and finding ways to make it so. The industry is in flux. It's not just U.S. Steel. It's the industry and the sector in its entirety. So we're reviewing all of that. And that has huge implications for the well-being of many families, and I recognize the concerns that the leader of the office, the third party, is making. We share them, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, this minister offered $3 million in transitional help. All I was asking is, where's the money? And he didn't answer my question, Speaker. It's quite disappointing. The Minister of Finance also said that the government will do everything we can to stand with the retirees as well as the employees. What that means for them, Speaker, is opening up the agreement, the deal that was signed between U.S. Steel and the federal government. Will this premier tell the people of our province, the retirees and their families, what commitments they've secured from the federal government to protect pensioners and the vital benefits of 20,000 U.S. Steel pensioners?
Seriously, Mr. Speaker, of course we've been trying to identify the secret deal that was made by the Harper government of the past, and we're trying to determine what that means going forward. But the member seems to be antagonistic here. We're trying to find ways to foster the well-being of these families. The money's available as required. We're going through those negotiations now. Her member has been actually at the table enabling us and working together, and we will continue to do that for the benefit of the people of Hamilton who are exposed by this, a very unfortunate situation. We're going to try to encourage and find ways to provide the greatest safeguards available to them, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you for your question. The member from Ottawa South.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Minister of Education. Yesterday marked the first day of Anti-Bullying Awareness and Prevention Week. The province has designated Bullying Awareness and Prevention Week on the third Sunday of November to help promote safe schools and a positive learning environment. 3 years ago, the Accepting School Act was passed in this legislature, and it requires school boards to take greater measures to prevent bullying and issue tougher consequences for those who bully others. Minister, what is the government doing to help provide students and teachers across the province a safe, inclusive, and accepting learning and teaching environment?
Thank you, Minister of Education.
Yes, and thank you very much to the member for the question. Ontario has a safe school strategy in place and specific policies that require that all schools have bullying prevention and intervention plans and procedures in place, as well as safe and accepting schools teams. These teams are made up of a variety of students, teachers, and people representing the community, and they are responsible for making sure that the school is providing a safe and welcoming learning environment for its students and staff. And as you know, Speaker, a safe and welcoming learning environment is so important. Schools have been provided with resources and trainings for teachers and principals to support the work of these teams. Schools are encouraged to work with their teams to educate students about all the different forms that bullying can take. That includes physical bullying, verbal bullying, social bullying, and electronic or cyberbullying, as we commonly know it, and all those different forms of bullying need to be dealt with.
Merci,
Monsieur le Président.
Last year, there was a prize that was given for safe schools in Ontario, and we want to thank them for their efforts and their contribution to different communities in the province. The elementary school in my riding was chosen for the Premier's Prize because they adopted this safety method.
A school climate survey conducted at École Élémentaire Catholique Lamoureux revealed more than 97% of students felt strongly that were supported and felt safe at school. Minister, please explain how other schools in Ontario can qualify as a recipient for the Premier's awards for accepting schools.
Thank you. Minister.
Yes, and my congratulations go out to École Élémentaire Catholique Lamoureux. Recipients of the Premier's Award for Accepting Schools are safe and accepting school teams who, one, demonstrate initiative, creativity, and leadership in at least three specified areas related to school climate. Secondly, they must identify the specific challenges faced by the team and how they were addressed. And thirdly, they provide evidence that the activities that they've arranged have made a significant difference in the school community. And the member just gave the example of 97% of students in the award-winning school feeling safe at school. All safe and accepting school teams across Ontario are eligible to apply for the Premier's Award for Accepting Schools. So once again, congratulations to the 10 school teams who have been selected this year for the award.
New question, member from Halliburton, Forth and Lakes Brock.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Energy. Today, the on-peak electricity price is 17.5 cents per kilowatt hour. That is more than four times what it was when the Liberal government first came to power. The government keeps saying that the increases were below their projections from the 2013 long-term energy plan, so apparently we're worrying too much. So the Ontario Energy Board even says that there is a simple solution to these soaring energy costs. Ontarians should just conserve a bit harder and work during off-peak hours. Residents in my riding of Halliburton, Forth and Lakes Brock are fed up with these poor policy choices from this government. Did the government expect seniors on fixed incomes to freeze during peak periods, businesses to close, and dairy cattle to hold their milk until off-peak hours? Mr. Speaker, how can the minister say to Ontarians that to better manage their bills, they should just stop working and heating their homes during on-peak hours?
Mr. Speaker, the member knows that our 2013 energy long-term energy plan's projected rates are coming in lower than projected, Mr. Speaker, and that the increases that have been announced recently are lower than those that were projected in our long-term energy plan, Mr. Speaker. In addition, Mr. Speaker, the member knows we are continuing to mitigate rates with a series of mitigation programs, Mr. Speaker. And again, I repeat, I don't think any of the members on that side, Mr. Speaker, have prepared a list of those programs and provided them publicly in their householders to the constituents, Mr. Speaker. We're still adding more mitigation measures, Mr. Speaker, to assist customers with their bills, and in the supplementary, Mr. Speaker, I'll go into more detail.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, Mr. Speaker, the bottom line is people are still paying more for energy. Wow. The Liberal government's long-term energy plan continues to subsidize industrial wind and solar power. The Ontario Energy Board even said that a third of the electricity increase came from the cost of this government's Green Energy Act. Ontarians shouldn't have to give up more of their hard-earned money just so that the government can stand on a soapbox and preach photo-op environmentalism. As it turns out, the government isn't green enough to stop wind turbines from popping up on the sensitive Oak Ridges Moraine in Manverse and Bethany in City of Forth and Lakes. Ontarians shouldn't have to continue to starve, freeze in the cold, and sell their homes because of this government's energy policies. Mr. Speaker, how can the minister continue to support energy policies that are starving and bankrupting hardworking Ontarians who are struggling to make ends meet every day?
Mr. Speaker, the member will know that as we sit here today, Mr. Speaker, the Ontario Energy Board is advertising through newspapers and other means, Mr. Speaker, the new Ontario Electricity Support Program, which for modest income families will save them $360 to $400 per year, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker,
never too late to get a warrant.
In addition to that, Mr. Speaker, we know that the debt retirement charge is coming off January 1st, Mr. Speaker, which will take another $70 per year off their bills, Mr. Speaker. And we are also reminding people starting now through January, February, Mr. Speaker, that for senior citizens, they will be able to apply for their tax credit and, Mr. Speaker, get up to $1,060 off their electricity rates, Mr. Speaker. There are a lot of programs that they can access, Mr. Speaker.
Answer.
And I
would ask the members opposite to communicate to their constituents those programs that are available rather than standing up here with rants, Mr.
Thank you. New question. The member from Essex.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Speaker, the government has announced that it is looking for public input into setting up a third-party certification program for compliance with Ontario's accessibility legislation, the AODA. By third-party, of course, this government means privatization, and any input is already being considered through this lens. This government shouldn't be interested in accessibility for Ontarians facing barriers because it's commercially viable or opens new markets. The government should be invested because it's in fact the law. How will this government ensure 10 years after the Accessibility for Ontarians Disability Act will finally be enforced?
Thank you, Premier.
Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure.
Minister of Economic Development, Speaker, Employment and Infrastructure.
Much to the temptation to go otherwise, I want to respond to the member's question. Yes, indeed, Mr. Speaker. While I was at an event with Colleges Ontario yesterday, where Rick Hansen was speaking as the motivational speaker, we were talking about an initiative that Rick Hansen has been a champion of. Mr. Speaker, that's looking at ways that we can reach out to the business community and recognize, Mr. Speaker, those businesses that are excelling and becoming accessible, through, similar to the way the LEADS program works with gold, platinum, bronze. Mr. Speaker, the leading person in this and the leading organization in doing this thus far in Canada has been Rick Hansen and his foundation. Mr. Speaker, we would be open to others doing this kind of work as well. But surely, Mr. Speaker, the member doesn't have a philosophical problem with this government working with Rick Hansen on accessibility.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, Rick Hansen certainly is one of our most revered advocates for people with disabilities. But unless the government intends on having Rick do the enforcement part of the AODA, I don't think you're actually going to be able to follow through with your commitments. And thank you, Rick. Thank you, Rick. Speaker, my brother is a quadriplegic. We know the barriers that people with injuries face. Advocates, disability advocates, have been clear they don't need certification. They need enforcements of the AODA. What does it matter if the source of the barrier has been certified? How will you enforce, after 10 years, how will you enforce the AODA?
Mr. Speaker, I know that this member cares a lot about this issue, and we do as well. And we're going to take our advice, Mr. Speaker, from experts like Rick Hansen, Mr. Speaker, because nobody knows better than Mr. Hansen when it comes to these issues. And, Mr. Speaker, we're going to use models that work and have worked in the past. And it's really important that we change the dynamics in this province and across this country when it comes to business perceptions about the needs and importance from a business case and becoming accessible. There are many ways we can do that. Compliance is one of them, Mr. Speaker. Enforcement is another. But it's really important that businesses embrace our ability to become accessible. And a LEADS-like program in Ontario would be a first in Canada and something we're working very close with the likes of Rick Hansen to achieve. We're proud of that.
Thank you.
And I would expect the member ultimately to support.
Thank you. A point of order, the President of Treasury Board.
Thank you, Speaker, and I'm delighted to welcome Dr. Gerald Smith from the Ontario Dental Association, who's joined us today for all of question period. Welcome, Doctor.
Thank you. The member from Renfrew, Nipissing, Pembroke.
Speaker, on behalf of my colleague from Niagara West, Glanbrook, I would like to welcome students from Our Lady of the Assumption Catholic Elementary School from Stony Creek here to the House today. Also, Cindy Lolua for grades 5 and 6, and Claire Rose Mascarenas for grades 4 and 5. Welcome to Queen's Park.
Thank you. We have a deferred vote on a motion for closure on the motion for second reading of Bill 109. Calling the members, this will be a 5-minute bell. Would all members please take their seats? All members, please take your seats. On October 8, 2015, Mr. Flynn moved second reading of Bill 109, an act to amend various statutes with respect to employment and labour. Ms. Albanese has moved that the question be now put. All those in favour of Ms. Albanese's motion, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Come on,
Ms.
Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
You don't want to
Mr. Nackley.
Mr.
Bradley.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Madame Mayor.
Madame Mayor.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms.
Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Duguid.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Balkus.
Mr. Balkus.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Kraft.
Mr. Kraft.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Ms. Jassic.
Ms. Jassic.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Dahmerla.
Ms. Dahmerla.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Verniel.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time to be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Arnold.
Mr. Arnold.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. McNaughton.
Mr. McNaughton.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Barrett.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Ms. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Singh.
Mr. Singh.
Ms. Horvath.
Ms. Horvath.
Mr. Vantar.
Mr. Vantar.
Ms. DeNovo.
Ms. DeNovo.
Mr. Tabbins.
Mr. Tabbins.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Mr. Nadishak.
Mr. Nadishak.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Madame Jelinat.
Madame Jelinat.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Forrester.
Ms. Forrester.
Ms. Campbell.
Ms. Campbell.
Mr. Montauk.
Mr. Montauk.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Ms. Gretzky.
Ms. Gretzky.
Ms. French.
Ms. French. The ayes are 53, the nays are 44.
The ayes being 53 and the nays being 54, I declare the motion carried. Mr. Flynn has moved second reading of Bill 109, an act to amend various statutes with respect to employment and labour. Is it the pleasure of the House to motion carry? I heard a no. All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, please say nay. In my opinion, the ayes have it. Calling the members, this will be a 5-minute bill.
Thank you.
Mr. Flynn has moved second reading of Bill 109, an act to amend various statutes with respect to employment and labour. All those in favour, please rise. In favour of the motion, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Nackney.
Mr. Nackney.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Madame Mayeur.
Madame Mayeur.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Duguid.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Barardinetti.
Mr. Barardinetti.
Mr. Dillon. Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Balkison.
Mr. Balkison.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Kraft.
Mr. Kraft.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Ms. Jassa.
Ms. Jassic.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Mr. Pott.
Mr. Pott.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Verniel.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Hartman.
Mr. Hartman.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. McLeod.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Miller, Perry Sound, Muskoka.
Mr. Miller, Perry Sound, Muskoka.
Mr. McNaughton.
Mr. McNaughton.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Barrett.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Ms. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettipiece.
Mr. Pettipiece.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the clerk.
Ms. Forster.
Ms. Forster.
Mr. Singh.
Mr. Singh.
Ms. Horvath.
Ms. Horvath.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Vantoff.
Ms. DeNovo.
Ms. DeNovo.
Mr. Tabbitt.
Mr. Tabbitt.
Mr. Miller, Hamilton East Stoney Creek.
Mr. Miller, Hamilton East Stoney Creek.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Mr. Nadishak.
Mr. Nadishak.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Madame Jelinas.
Madame Jelinas.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Campbell.
Ms. Campbell.
Mr. Montauk.
Mr. Montauk.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Ms. Gretzky.
Ms. Gretzky.
Ms. French.
Ms. French. The ayes are 78, the nays are 19.
The ayes being 78 and the nays being 19, I declare the motion carried.
Second reading of the bill, deuxième lecture, projet de loi.
Shall the bill be ordered for third reading? Third reading? Yes? Shall be ordered?
To the judge?
The speaker.
Oh, good.
Shall be referred to the Justice Committee. Point of order, the member from Eglinton Lawrence.
There's some very unparliamentary language used by the leader of the third party. She should withdraw immediately.
I heard that.
I listened to as to the point of order. All members have their own watch to see whether or not they've said anything. If I've heard it, I did not. And if anyone does use unparliamentary language, I rely on them to identify and withdraw. There are no deferred votes. There are no further deferred votes. This House stands recessed until 3 p.m. this afternoon.